So, good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good morning to everybody, good morning, dear colleagues. I welcome you to this workshop session. I would like to say a few words before we begin about the format of this event and about, because we have some guests from abroad and from other universities. And I, before we start, I want to introduce you to the whole concept of this working seminar and our events. So it's a pleasure for me to welcome you on behalf of the Technical University of Sofia and our colleagues. This is our summer recreation facility, which we use for a lot of conferences and seminars, which help us come with better ideas, exchange some knowledge, and make new relationships and do some networking in a little bit more informal environment. So the title of today's workshop is Knowledge Management, Human Capital and Well-being. And the idea for this workshop came as a result of my experience over the years as a researcher and the development of my career. To be honest, I thought that I'll invite all colleagues I've worked through the years and that helped me become what I have become as a researcher. So our keynote speaker for today is Professor Guy Ahonen, who introduced me to the concept of knowledge management and well-being and intellectual capital. And I started working in that field, and I've been working in that field for over maybe 10 or 15 years now. So the idea is that we share our views, share what we've been working on as researchers recently with colleagues and people that are interested in, and test our results or share our results where we come to at the moment, and together try to find new answers, see what are the research problems in this field, which is quite interesting. Actually, this is a boundary field combining several disciplines. So we'll start with our keynote, and I'll give the floor to Professor Ahonen, and then we'll proceed and with the other papers.
Thank you, Lydia, and good morning, everybody, and thank you for good company last night. My wife and I enjoyed it really. It's our first visit here, so it's absolutely wonderful. And first of all, I would like to congratulate the organizers for a good topic. This is not a very usual combination of words that you see here on the general topic of this seminar. I mean, and still, I think it's very important. I'm happy to be able to share some of the findings that my colleagues and myself have come to during the recent years. And my topic is strategic well-being, strategy relevant management, Finnish experiences 2009-2016. I'm going through a few things during the coming 20 minutes. What is strategic HRM or personnel management, what makes personnel management strategy relevant, and what is strategic well-being, and finally, what are the financial benefits of managing strategic well-being. Let me first start with a few remarks about strategic HRM. Peter Boxall, in his very covering review, concludes that a theory of strategic HRM must explain the relationship between strategic management and employment relations in the firm. That's quite general and somewhat obvious. The other quite descriptive of this field is his second remark, where he says that big picture shows that dominant emphasis has been on the short-term survival rather than long-term advantage. And I think this is something that we all who work in this field have to take into account. Our Finnish recent data, which is not published yet, we just actually have compiled data this spring, shows something related to this common notions about human resource management. We looked at, asked Finnish SMEs about their strategic priorities, and as you can see, the personnel aspect, direct personnel aspect, personnel productivity, which we assume that personnel well-being has to do with, only comes as a third priority, which is not bad, of course, but we would think that it would be good for it to be actually on the top in a modern organization. But as you can see, our data shows that business competitiveness and financial performance is the top priority, and then come the customer issues, and first then the personnel. On the other hand, when we ask companies directly about their HRM priorities, then the picture is like this. Then the competence of the personnel is in focus, and the corporate climate. And that's, of course, for everybody of us who are working in the IC field, we see that this is of course very relevant. There is the human capital aspect. There is the internal structure, and in addition to that comes, if you think about the intellectual capital, comes the external relations. Then as a second priority is supportive leadership, and then only then comes work, managing work as such. As, and some of the research in Finland are very disappointed that company management pays so little attention to directly to the work and work how it is administered and all the aspects of it. But that's how it is. Then yet a few remarks about the strategic ARM. Becker and Husalid say that in their framework, strategic impact of the HR architecture that he is focusing and they have been focusing many years, and it should be directly and is directly related to strategic value creation by the business processes, which I agree with. And Becker and Husely, they have created their, you could say, huge model, where in the one end you have the strategy, and in the other end you have performance. And they managed to show that it matters how this HR architecture is designed. And these researchers are one of the few who have really managed to also relate this personnel management architecture to financial performance. And here is I think is a quite impressive slide about how that HR architecture can impact on the company performance. In this case, this architecture is related to the market value of the company. And for us who have been working in the IC field, the market value is really a central indicator of economic performance. And you can see that going from the according to Becker and Husli, the worst architecture to the best can increase the market value of the company by 35%, which is of course a huge difference. Becker and Husli, they have a, you could say, quite general approach to HR, and some of my colleagues and I, we have wanted deliberately to look at how the management of personnel well-being affects the company and ultimately its performance. And in 2008-2009, Ossi Naura and Johan Ilmarin and myself decided that that we wanted to look at work well-being from a, you could say, business relevant point of view. So, and we noticed that the previous concepts used were biased, you could say, to the employer side, and so we created a new concept which we called strategic well-being. And relating to that concept, we developed a large questionnaire which we have used for many years. The concept of strategic well-being is such that by strategic well-being we mean that part of the well-being of the personnel which has relevance and importance and supports the effectiveness of the core activities of the organization, or I would say more more directly, it's those parts of personnel well-being which has relevance for the economic performance of the company.
And then management,
some very interesting results of that well-being.
Here are the management
the data that I'll use. This is
a structured
randomized selection of Finnish
for how well companies,
both in the private and public sector, managing
and well-being.
We have measured towards all the relevant sectors at the beginning every year, and all organization sizes, so there are small, medium and large organizations included. That data over from 2009 to 2016 covers 2,200 companies, and it's an quite impressive data, because companies nowadays don't want to answer questionnaires, and our questionnaires is very, very large. But it gives us some wonderful data, the model that we used this looks like this. This is of course the basic outline, looks like the European Polity Award model, but the content is quite different. You could say that it consists of two parts. We have this the management part, which consists of those four elements: strategic base of well-being in companies, well-being in management functions and formership and HR practices, and well-being support functions. And there is a list of what is included, and under all those items we have tens of questions each, so it's about 100 questions in the questionnaire, and that is the basis for the strategic well-being management index. Then we assume that all that has an impact on the performance on the organization, and on the performance side we have individual performance and also community on the performance on the community level, and that we assume and have shown that has an impact on both productivity of the organization and the cost level, or the production cost level of the organization. We think that it's important to keep these two things separate,
I don't have slides on that now, but talking about this difference, we have been able to show that when you look at Finnish organizations, they concentrate on cost reduction, not on productivity increase. And we have been able to show that productivity increase is much more effective than cost reduction. And we think that cost reduction approaches, they are perhaps the most primitive approaches to personnel management or management in a large context. But and that is something that we perhaps would like to dig deeper into in the future. All that has an impact on the overall financial performance of the company. Well, what kind of impact is there? In this following slide, we have collected the data from all those 6 years. Actually, we did it now the seventh year now in 2018, but that study isn't yet completed. But this slide shows the overall relationship between managing the strategic well-being and the economic performance of the company. As you can see, I think this is absolutely amazing. This is the poor, if you put it into five different levels, this is poor strategic well-being. It has the lowest index. This is worst, the blue is excellent performance, and this is worst performance from previous years. And this is statistically significant differences. And of course, the result could have been anything, but it is like this. And because of these results, we decided in 2016 to write a book. The book is in Finnish. Unfortunately, we hope we could translate it, because we think this could be of interest for a larger audience. That's the overall picture. Then we have a number of I think interesting details in our study. Here is one. We have checked what impact setting goals has for the performance success, and here the third column is the companies having set goals for strategic well-being or personnel well-being, and the lighter column is no goals, and you can see that these are all statistically significant results. So we have economic performance differences, we have workability performance differences, formership performance, image performance. So you could say that from all intangible aspects, only that detail, setting goals for this area, makes a huge difference for the company performance. Then another, you could say, technical difference is having steering groups for the work well-being. It also, if you have a steering group, you don't have, that seems to make a huge difference. So when I'm asked, what can you do to improve work well-being and the performance of the company? My answer is that it's a lot of things, but there are a few quite general things that you can do. And one thing is that you set quantitative goals for your activities, and you organize it effectively by having a steering group for these issues. We have a lot of results, so I only picked a few. Here is we have looked at the development discussions in companies and how it relates to the different forms of performance, and a couple of years ago, I think that one of the big international consultancy companies said that they have skipped development discussions. And because of that discussion in Finland, we decided to look deeper into this, and we found that we don't recommend skipping development discussions. It seems to have a huge impact on performance. We have, depending on how much the personnel well-being aspect is included in the development discussions, the economic performance is increased, corporate climate is increased, workability is increased, and the perceived own competence. So they, those discussions, they are not only waste of time, they really affect how the organization works. And then another heated discussion is about work-life balance and performance, and in Scandinavia the work-life balance is an increasingly relevant topic all over. There has been talk about it for decades, but now it's in Sweden and Finland this is something that is really starting to get hot, and our data indicates that if you have if the management pays a lot of attention to work balance issues, then at least corporate image is improved and the corporate climate. So you could say the internal structure and the external structure is improved. So here again you have a few of these central elements of intangible assets which are affected by taking into account this, you could say, according to some people, very soft element of management. But it's not that soft, actually. It's in a modern world company, it is actually, it seems to be increasingly important. Then inspired by all research, in 2015, we decided to introduce a new concept, which we call the Personal Productivity Index. And it consists of three elements. It's motivation and engagement of the personnel, the experienced competence, and the experience workability. And we have data which we got from an insurance company over all these aspects of the personnel on individual level. And we managed to get accounting and financial data from of all these companies, and we looked how does this concept, this what we called personal productivity elements, how do they relate to the financial performance of the company? And this is our result. If you look at the personal productivity index and you calculate it like we did, and you divide it into three groups. You have the low, medium, and high. And then you look at the operating profit. That it means that really the cold euros that you end up with in your company operation. The difference is in the lowest group you have 500, in average 500 euro operating profit, and in the highest group you have 1,400, which is it's actually a 180% increase. And we to make this comparison or the data comparable, we took one branch of industry, we took construction industry, we took one size companies, it was the medium sized companies, and we took only a certain type of construction because there is road construction and so on which we excluded. So this is this data is very comparable, and you have this amazing difference. This means that by managing these three elements, the motivation and engagement of the personnel, their perceived competence and their perceived work ability, you can, in principle, you can triple the result, the financial result of the company. In the 2016 strategic well-being survey, we included this concept in the questionnaire, and looked how the companies evaluate their personnel, these three elements, and then related that to the strategic well-being index. And this is our result, which we are, of course, are very happy about. It tells that if you look at the level estimated strategic well-being management index, and you have from poor to excellent, and then we look at how does the personnel productivity index relate to that, you can see again a statistically significant relationship there, which we of course again were very happy about. It showed that the way that we manage strategic well-being, it also has relevance for this this PPI concept that we developed. Now we have this conviction that managing strategic well-being, or managing the personnel, or managing the well-being and the personnel in general, it's not only fixing one or two things here and there. It's a comprehensive process. And this slide shows how that works. In the first part of it, we look at how we have data on how much the well-being, personnel well-being, is included in strategic processes, from not all to a lot. And then we look at how does that relate to leadership competence levels. So we go from overall strategic aspect to a leadership level, and we see that there is a clear relationship. The next, we ask how does the leadership competence level, which in the x-axis, how does that relate to personnel productivity? And there are the factual competence and emotional competence of the managers. And there is again a significant relationship, a clear relationship. And finally, we go to from this personnel productivity, as I showed before, which is now on the x-axis, and we can show that that has a clear effect on the operating profit of the company. I can't find more convincing research results on how important it is to take into account personnel well-being as an major issue of managing overhead, and of course managing the personnel. So to conclude, I would say that personnel well-being is an essential intangible asset of modern organizations. Two, strategic well-being is a matter of management, leadership and personnel productivity, all these things together. And finally, including personnel well-being in corporate strategy enhances financial performance, even doubles it. Thank you. Questions?
So, any questions from the audience?
Yes, it was very interesting for me, your work, your results, and the task of well-being. And I think when I see the results, if you made some attention about the connection between calling your choice of specific profession that is suitable to your personality and well-being, This is the question that arises in my mind.
Okay. You mean that if you would look at the suitability of your personality and your place in the organization,
yes, and your profession,
have an impact? Yeah, I'm sure it would be. That would be an interesting thing to add to the analysis. Yes, that's a good point. I'm sure it's good.
I have a question, and I would like to ask you to explain a little bit more about the Finnish concept of workability, which is not very popular in Bulgaria, and I'm sure most of the people in this room are not familiar with it, and what is the relationship between workability and well-being, and how this affect productivity of personnel?
Yeah, that's a good and important question. In Finland, in the 80s, we started looking very deeply into employability, increasing employability of people, because there was many people were unemployed and then the Finnish Institute of Occupational Health is the second biggest, or used to be the second largest organization in this field in the world after the American equivalent. So there, this concept of workability was developed, and it was developed on the basis of the idea that workability, the ability to work, perform on the workplace, is not only a thing that is related to you as a person. So there are other aspects. There is, of course, this personal health aspect, but then there is the community aspect. You work in a community. Then there is the work and environment aspect, and then there is the leadership aspect. But anyway, there was a realization that being able to work is not only a factor which is related to you as a person, and I think it's an important thing. And on basis of that idea, the workability index concept was created, and you could say that Finland has the most comprehensive occupational health service in the world. According to law, everybody has to be included. So almost every employer's workability index has been measured at some stage. So all occupational health services have the workability index of all the employers, and that's a fantastic data, because that workability index it correlates with many important things, and it tells about the state of the person, the health state of the personnel. So that is something that used to be only a Finnish phenomenon, but now it's spreading over the world. Juhani Ilmarin, who was the father of the concept, he is now retired, but he still works all over the world with projects with this workability index. So it's now, when we are going from workability to work well-being, other countries are adopting the workability concept. Work well-being is still slightly larger concept, which takes into account also this work-life balance. That's an expansion from the workability in the workability concept to the work well-being concept. Somebody could think that the work well-being concept is a more narrow concept than workability, but that's not the case how it has been defined in Finland. And we have had some success in using these concepts during the last 10 years. Finland is the country in Europe that has increased most the occupation level of people in 50 to 60 years, the working percentage.
Thank you so much for your amazing presentation. I have two questions, one large, big, and one very precise. And I will start following your answer just now with this large question. What's happened with this Finnish experiment, social experiment, to pay people for 1 year? Do you know what I mean?
Yes,
is
I
it
know.
Connected
I
think with this your constructive well-being? Because it looks for me opposite to the logic of well-being and
yes,
work balance, work-job balance, life balance.
Yes.
What's happened with this experiment?
I think that you mean it. We have introduced this what do you call it? It's a Kansalaispalkka. That's my wife there in the last page. It's you get the monthly pay whether you work or not.
50 euros, I think it is.
I think it's 600 euros per month. Yes, and so there is an experiment. And we think that that's going to be the future all over the world. So it lowers the pressure on having to be employed. Of course, 600 euros is not very much in Finland, but you can survive on it. Now this is the 2017 was the first year, and there has not yet been any report on that, so we don't know yet. But it's a interesting question. I look forward to getting those.
Yes,
and the second question was?
Yeah. And my second question is very concrete, very small. What do you mean? Maybe it's a part of lost of translation dialogue. Factual competence. You compare factual competence with emotional
factual competence.
You mean expertise, technical knowledge?
No, it's actually factual competence relating to handling people. I mean that you know things. You know that that people get stressed if you treat them in certain ways, and less stressed if you treat them in other. There is a lot of knowledge about that. Some managers know it, some don't, and we have been able to measure their knowledge level. That's a factual. Then this emotional competence is more, you could say, you know what it is, and it's more in a personal level.
Thank you.
Yes.
I'm asking because I'm busy with all these problems of competence and another perspective, but it's quite interesting for me. And my second and last question about the term, what does it mean, foremanship performance? Foremanship, it's a formal, official?
No, it's a... that's a matter of translation, because in Finnish vocabulary we have the word esimies. So it's your immediate manager or form. That and there is
short term.
No, immediate.
Yes,
thank you. Yes,
you are.
Okay.
And I have one last question, and it is, have you, in your study, have you studied the attitude and how Finnish management applies this concept, how they handle this work-life balance and work well-being in practice? Mm-hmm. Are there any special measures that companies do, and are all companies knowledgeable and aware about the importance of this and actually applying it? Mm-hmm. Or some of them are not, and how you evaluate?
Unfortunately, it's not very widespread yet. Those companies which are very successful in personnel management, who have accomplished amazing results. There is one garbage company in Finland, Lassila Tikanoja, who work in a very hard branch of industry, and they, by adopting this model, they have increased the average retirement age from 59 to 62. And that's an amazing result. If all Finnish companies would do that, then we would have no public debt at all in Finland. So But there is a handful of companies which are very good at this. And because they have such amazing results, I'm really surprised why other companies don't follow. But and I have thought, of course, a lot about it. And my answer is that our adopted model of looking at the core activities of the company is really the crook in this drama. Companies don't look outside the core. Of course, this is not core activity of any company, and still you have to do it right. But so companies, the managers, they just listen politely and then they go back to their firms and do as usual. So, but I hope that there will be a breakthrough. Our data is I think it's quite convincing. But there is something else which stands in the way. Let's hope for the best. Okay, thank you.
Any more questions? Okay, so thank you.